Hello everyone, nice to meet you. I'm Alex. I'm a full stack developer at E.ON, and yeah, I'm also an AI enthusiast. And today I would like to talk about AI in business and an application for this approach will be predicting the temperature in a room using AI. As you know, I'm working for E.ON, and I will just show you some insights about the company. So yeah, if you are wondering who we are a company that is doing insourcing software, and yeah, we are for more than 4 years in Iași. And if you are interested in projects that we are developing, we also have some positions in the machine learning and data scientist, data engineering field. And yeah, if you know friends or you are interested, please contact the company and yeah, we can bring you more information about this. Yeah, we have a lot of technologies and yeah, multiple clouds. And yeah, we are getting more and more advanced in the software industry. Okay, I think we can go with the another one. Yes, hello. Okay, so yeah, let's see what we have for today. We have 7 items, and yeah, we will have the introduction. We will have the input of this model that we want to train. And yeah, the input is a time series data set. The output is a prediction that we want to achieve. Basically, we will see in the next slides what the outlook looks like. And yeah, we will do some quality metrics and model evaluation. We want to see if the model is predicting well or not. We will see. And yeah, we will see a comparison with another model. It's not a time series one, but yeah, we wanted to compare with another one from the market. And yeah, some conclusions and some features that I think it's nice to know about Prophet. So what's the problem? The problem is that we want to predict room temperature from a building. So yeah, later on we can optimize the consumption. Maybe we can be proactive and turn off and on some sensors. Maybe we can benefit from the heat that is going from the sun. And yeah, long story short, we want to predict the temperature in a room. What are we using as input? Basically, as input, we use different building system features like sensors, set point schedules. So we have a lot of air heating units. And other elements, network elements that are recording data, meters. And also we wanted to see the dependency with the weather features like temperature, humidity, wind speed, and so on, but mainly the weather forecast. Good. Why we choose the Prophet AI? We choose Prophet AI because, even though on the market there are also other predictors like IMA and other models, we wanted to benefit from the seasonality. So we wanted also to detect seasonability. So Prophet, it's good when detecting seasonability like year seasonability, monthly, daily, and so on. And also he can take into consideration the holidays, which is nice because we can also add this effect. For example, if we have a store that is managed by the company, we can also know that if it's 1st of January, nobody will be in that store because the store will be closed. And we can also, if 1st of January will be in a day during the week, we can also have this impact and we can predict the impact of that holiday for our prediction. So it's nice because we can take into consideration the holidays and other major events like soccer championship or other Black Friday, for example, and so on. Also, if you have any questions, please interrupt me and I will just try to answer. Okay. As an observation, I want to say that even though we are considering a lot of data for input, and when I say a lot of data, I'm thinking about several features that we take into consideration. It's also important to understand that for the period that we want to predict the output, we will also need feature data for those features. So for example, if I'm taking into consideration only the weather, I will need the weather forecast for the feature period so that I can do a forecast on that period. Okay. Let's see what we have here. Yeah, so basically we had a bunch of features that we took into our analysis, and we were not sure which one of them are better or yeah. So we just analyzed them and we did analysis for feature importance. I think this was done with XGBoost. So we see a strong correlation with the outside temperature. So basically the output is the inside temperature that we want to predict, the room temperature that we want to predict. When we try to understand what other dependencies are correlated with the inside temperature. So we saw this temp is the outside temperature. We saw a strong correlation with the outside temperature. Also we have some sensors that we get data from. We have a schedule. This schedule is like a timer. You can think of a thermostat that we have in each room. Basically, these buildings have air heating units and so on. And those air heating units and other devices have a lot of sensors. So we took all of these features and we tried to understand what is the feature importance for our model. Even though we are using Prophet, we did the feature importance analysis with XGBoost. We just wanted to detect some sensors that we want to take into consideration as input for the Prophet. Good. Yeah, I think an image is saying a lot of words. So I will just start from the beginning with showing the prediction that we obtained. So basically, the blue trend is the real one, is the reality. And the orange one is the prediction that we did. Basically, we wanted to see if at noon we will have sun outside and if the room will be heated, because maybe in the morning we will not heat that building so hard, because yeah, maybe the sun will come up and the air heating unit will take heated air from outside. And yeah, if we don't have this prediction, let's say I'm using a strong heating of the room, and when the sun will be on top of the building, and if the air heating will take hot air from the outside, let's say that I'm turning the cooling. So in the morning I'm heating too much, and in the noon I have to cool the building. So maybe if we can predict the temperature, we can fine-tune the parameters so that we can save some energy. So this is the main idea that we've tried to achieve here. In the left, we have the degrees Celsius, and you can see it's pretty accurate. Yeah, and also it follows the trend. So basically, we just wanted to see, you see the red thresholds. Our interest area is the red thresholds. But yeah, we also did the longer prediction, and yeah, we were pleased for the result. This is not the initial result. We had several trials, but yeah, this is one of the nicest prediction that we have. Good. Any questions so far? Good. Yeah, basically, this is only the output that we are seeing here. And the output of the model is the inside temperature that we predicted. And also, let's see the input parameters. So basically, we put, this is an example of several features that can be added to Prophet. So basically, he supports several regressors. And yeah, the temp is the outside temperature. For example, we added the humidity. And yeah, wind speed and other sensors. This is just a sample. Basically here, we have only some outside temperature information parameters, but basically we also, in our prediction, we are using also other features like other sensors that we found relevant. This is only for displaying purpose. We want to show that it's nice that the Prophet model also supports several input parameters. So yeah, which is nice. Hello. Mm-hmm. Hello. Good. So basically, we also wanted to evaluate the model because, yeah, as every model, we want to see if he's smart enough or if he's, doing a good prediction or not. Because, yeah, what is a model that cannot do a good prediction? How are we doing this? Also, Prophet has some nice features. So it has, among the prediction that he can do, he has also some nice tools that you can use, like some validations that you can do. So basically you can do a cross validation and you can display some performance metrics. We will see also a plot. What we can see here is just some root mean square error values. So we can see that we have like 0.1, the root mean square error is 0.1, which means like this is the mean. It's a small value, which is good. And we also have the map. This is like a percentage error that we've analyzed. And we had like zero. This is not the best one, but we will see a better one. So this is like 26 percentage errors. This was not the final analysis. This is just a sample. We will see a better analysis. So this is one of the best analysis that we did. So you can see that we obtained like 0.59 degrees error, the root mean square error, which is nice. And the percentage we obtained like 0.022, which means it's 22 percentage, it's a 2% error. And yeah, a 2% error for our timeline that we want to predict like a few hours, it's nice that we obtain only 2% of errors. Also compared with XGBoost, even though these models are not both for time series, the Prophet is fitted for time series. We also wanted to experiment with another one and we just choose another one, which is not a classical time series predictor, but we wanted to analyze the data and compare it. And yeah, the results are similar. So if here we obtain a 2.2% error, in the XGBoost we obtained like a 2.3. So the difference is slightly small, but yeah, Prophet has other advantages that we will see later. Amongst them, we have the seasonability analysis. So we can see the yearly, the week, the monthly, the weekly seasonability, which is a nice thing to do because you can see what is the cycle of your events and you can understand the evolution cycle of your events. And yeah, XGBoost, you have to do a lot of manual processing, analysis, cleanup and so on. So it's more work to do in XGBoost, and profit it's more fitted for the time series problem that we want to tackle. Good. As I told you that we will see also some plotting. So this is the plotting from the measurements. It's also embedded in the profit tool, so you can achieve these values very easy. We saw that cross-validation, and basically we can see the root mean square error and the MAPE percentage error during the evolution of time. So basically on the X axis, we have the hours, and on the Y axis, we have the value. So basically what we can see here that for 20 hours of prediction, we have like a 0.5 degrees error, which is nice. We can see that as time evolves and we go to nearly 2 days, we can see that the error grows bigger. And yeah, also we can see, let's see the percentage, because also I think the percentage is more fitted for data analysis. So for the percentages, we can see that we have 2% of error for 20 hours, for example. So for one day we have 2% of error, and we can go to like 3, near 4% error for 2 days, for example. It's nice that this cross-validation feature is embedded in Prophet. So yeah, we can benefit of it out of the box. We will see later how this cross-validation is working, but it's nice that Prophet has these out of the box tools that we can use to analyze the model, analyze the performance. Yeah, it's nice because you can use these tools out of the box. This is the prediction that we did with XGBoost, and it's the graph that we did. We can see that the error is slightly almost like 2 degrees. It's also similar, but it's not that accurate as the Prophet. As I said, we wanted to compare to a model, even though XGBoost is not a time series model. We just wanted to test it. We wanted to test the Prophet against the XGBoost model. Yeah, we can see that the blue line is the reality and the orange one is the prediction. And yeah, we can see some slightly differences. Good. Okay, so let's see some conclusions. Why are we choosing Prophet and not XGBoost? Yeah, basically, as the title says, Prophet model is a better model for time series, and also it's good for this seasonality that we will see later how it behaves. And yeah, it's also free. Also, the documentation is online, so yeah, it's open to the public and we can use it. Why don't we use Arima or XGBoost? Because yeah, both of them require more work from the developer point of view, and yeah, I think we developers tend to be efficient. Okay. Yeah, as I stated before, we like the idea of using Prophet because it's more suited for time series, and we also can put holidays, and we can see the seasonality of the events. Some features of Prophet. I think this is the only equation that I have in the presentation. So basically the Prophet model, it's a general additive model, and yeah, it has a component for the trend. It has a component for the seasonality, and it has also a component for the holidays. Yeah, let's see some pictures. So, basically, we can see that we have some plotting that is also done out of the box. So basically, this is the output, the classical output of profit. This is the official documentation. Samples that we have on the official Facebook site. By the way, profit is used by Facebook, and yeah, it's open source. So basically, this is an example of a football player from USA, and yeah, we can see this is the output, and we can see some nice insights. Basically, we can see the trend. So, for example, we have this evolution over 9 years, and we can see that maybe this player is getting older, and yeah, the trend is descending. But what is interesting is that we can see the profit detected some seasonality, and we can see a weekly seasonality. And yeah, for example, we can see that a lot of his matches are on Monday, which is nice because you can understand when your process is highly used or not. For example, for our inside temperature, we can see that we have higher temperatures on Mondays in that room. We can also, this brings also some interesting business insights, because you can see, okay, for example, on Mondays I have higher temperatures in that room. Why? Maybe if it's a store, maybe we have a lot of offers on Mondays, and yeah, maybe also a lot of people are getting into the store. So also this seasonality can bring some business insights for the analyst. Also have the yearly. So for example, some important matches are done in January and February, and we can see the yearly seasonability. We can see that in this area, in January and February, we have some high values. So it's nice that Profit can detect this seasonality, and we can understand, okay, what happens with my process. For example, for our case, we can see that if this will be the inside temperature, we will see that in January we have a lot of heat in that room, for example. And yeah, we can see the trend of that seasonability. I think this is nice because it also brings some, you not only predict the future, but you can also see some seasonabilities that can bring insights to your analysis. Another feature of Profit is the holidays effect. So yeah. Maybe you want, if you analyze for a store or something, maybe you have Black Fridays, maybe you have Super Bowls, as USA has. And for example, we've added some holidays. This is from the official documentation, a sample. So basically, these playoffs are some matches that are done in January, and also some Super Bowls that are done in February. And yeah, we can also see a graph of holidays, and we can see that basically, for example, the playoffs and the Super Bowl are overlapping, and the effect of that holiday is bigger. And we can see here that the effect is stronger for that holidays. And we can also see from this yearly seasonability, we can understand that because these important matches are in January and February, we can also see in January and February, we see a higher trend in the seasonability. So this means that not only the regular features are impacting the process, we can also see the impact of the holidays. So because we have these holidays, In this area, we can see that also this value is higher. So yeah, I think it's nice to have, and yeah, we can extract other information for the business. Another feature is a change point detection, and you can also provide some manual change points. Basically, let's say that we've launched a new iPhone, we can add some manual change points and we can see what happens. For example, here, these change points are auto-detected. We can see that the trend is changing. And for example, from here on, the trend is constant. We didn't have any change points. So these change points can be seen as automatically, and we can just get something from the data, and we can say, okay, something happened during that period, or we can also add some manual change points, and we can impact the trend. Other stuff that we have here is the support for the multiplicative seasonality. For example, we can see in the left, basically, this is an additive behavior. So we can see that we start small here in the left and we are going stronger. By the way, the black dots are the real samples. So the real data samples. The blue one is the prediction and the light blue is the interval of confidence per se. We can see here that we start small and we go bigger with the points, but yeah, the graph is somehow constant. We can put a parameter which says, okay, please do a multiplicative effect. And if we put that parameter, we can see that also the prediction is following the real samples. So this is nice because if we have this kind of multiplicative behavior, yeah, we can use it. Okay. As I said, Prophet supports also linear and nonlinear models, some regressors, and yeah, for example, in the right one, we can put a logistic growth model, and for example, the graph will saturate. For example, let's say that we have in an area, we have the number of population that has internet access. For example, in that area, prediction will not be able to predict more people in that area because that is the population. So this feature is nice because we can set a threshold and the prediction will stop because this is the threshold. So yeah, basically it's nice that we can have this kind of thresholds. Yeah, let's see a little bit. We saw earlier some tables and some graphs regarding the quality metrics. As I said, Prophet has some out-of-the-box cross-validation. And what's the mechanism behind it? Basically, these black dots are the real samples. And yeah, basically we train the model. We do a cutoff, and for a horizon span, we do a prediction. And after that, we just shift the cutoff and we do another cutoff and so on and so on. And in the end, we will achieve a table like this. And yeah, we can see some quality metrics like root mean square error. These are the values that I've took into consideration, the root mean square error and the MAPI versions, the MAPI parameters. For example, we can see here that we have from the MAPI, I like it because it's in percentage. So yeah, we can see that we have like 5, 5, 5, 6 percentage of error. So not only that the cross-validation is a tool that is supported by Prophet, also this quality metrics can be analyzed. We can take them and put them, plot them, do everything we want with them. Okay. Yeah, another feature that that I liked is the hyperparameter tuning. Basically, we didn't have a need to use this, but yeah, it is supported and I think it's nice. Let's see it a little bit in the documentation. So yeah, basically we have the official documentation here. We can check a lot of features that that are supported, and yeah, as I said before, we can also take advantage of the hyperparameter tuning. And yeah, for example, we can see some aspects that are relevant for us. For example, this change point prior scale and seasonability prior scale are some parameters that we can fine tune the change point impact and also the seasonability impact. For example, maybe I want to fine tune the seasonability to be harder or slower. So yeah, basically these are some parameters that usually are automatically done by Prophet. They have some default values, but they can also be tuned. And let's say I'm not sure what parameters to use. I can use this hyperparameter tuning facility to just generate some values, and I can see the root mean square error. And yeah, for example, I can choose the best one, which is I think this one. So I can see that for these values, I will obtain a better root mean square error. Good. This is also the graph that we saw earlier. So yeah, basically we are just training the data for initial area, and after that we do some cutoffs and some trainings. After that, after a period, we do again a cutoff and also a prediction. So the prediction is for that horizon, and we just shift the cutoffs and do another prediction. And in the end, we will have this kind of tables. And the other one, which is nicer, is the performance metrics that I showed you. And we can see what is the evolution of the error for several days. For example, I want to see from day one to day 40, for example. And I can see how the error evolves and how the model degrades over time. Personally, I've just used the, as I said, root mean square error and the map parameters. And yeah, I think it's a nice feature. Regarding the parameters that we can use, we also saw the growth, and we can put for nonlinear, we can put a logistic growth, and yeah, we will have this saturation. I think it has some nice features. Let's see, for example, a manual change point specification. So basically these change points can be automatically detected. We didn't use these ones, but yeah, I saw that they are supported, and it's a nice feature. You can see if something important occurred during the prediction. And also, as I said, I think you can also add some manual change points. For example, here you can provide your personal change points. So yeah, if you think an event like a new iPhone occurred, you can just put that change point in your prediction, which yeah, I think it's nice. If someone is curious, you can also check the paper. It's an interesting paper. Behind this model, it's called forecasting at scale. So basically what they wanted to do with this model Yeah, they wanted to narrow the gap between the analyst and the business manager per se. So the analyst knows how to fine tune those models and so on, but he doesn't know the business. On the other hand, the businessman or the manager knows the business, knows the rules, but he is not an analyst per se. And yeah, they wanted to narrow this gap and make the life of both easier. So this way also the analyst can do some business tuning, and also the business person can understand the plotting and can say, okay, I see this seasonality, I see this stuff, and yeah, I want to change something. So basically they just promote this analyst in the loop automated. So they say that, okay, you do a modeling, you do a forecasting, you evaluate the forecasting, you identify some problems, and you go and fine tune some parameters, and yeah, you improve the forecasting. This was the idea of the creators. And yeah, as I said, at Facebook, they have, as in other business events, that are occurring from Monday to Sunday, and they just plot them. And they wanted also this tool can be used to detect anomalies. For example, these are some outliers, and we can also use this profit model to identify outliers or anomalies in the system. For example, these outliers can be detected because Facebook will profit AI, which is done by Facebook. The profit model will do the trend, and you will see that these dots, for example, will be in the outside area of the trend and also in the outside area of the confidence interval. So with this profit model, you can also identify outliers. So basically they've compared with other models, and they figured out that other models do stuff good, but they are good in their area. They don't have also seasonality. They don't have a trend. They don't have all in one. So basically they just wanted to have a tool that does everything regarding time series and can solve all these problems that they identified. So basically they identified that other models are having some problems at the end of the year. We have next. So yeah, this is the model that is behind the scenes. So yeah, it supports also linear and nonlinear. Basically, the trend has this is the nonlinear formula, which is basically is a logistic one, and this is the capacity that we can put. For example, that example that we had with the trend, if you have a maximum population or a maximum number of something, you can add the capacity and you can have this growth saturation. This is the linear model. If someone wants to verify the formulas behind them, okay, they can do. So what is interesting is that for the seasonability, let's go in the other way. For the seasonability, we are using some the model is using some some Fourier series. And you can also do some fine tuning in that area. So basically you can play with the Fourier order. You can, we can have these custom parameters, and you can just fine tune your prediction. this is not the prediction, this is just the seasonability. So the prediction is only for the trend. Only the trend has the prediction. This is only the seasonability that we can see. Yeah, we can also turn off or on some seasonability parameters. And yeah, we can also play with the Fourier order. You can check different Fourier orders, or maybe you can just start the hyperparameter tuning mechanism and check. Yeah, for example, this is the prediction. So basically, the prediction lays only in the trend. So we can see here that the prediction is going like this. The strong blue line is the main one, and yeah, the light blue is for the confidence of the prediction. And we can see here that we have the year seasonability and monthly seasonability. And yeah, there are several parameters that you can fine tune. We didn't have any to use this, but it was nice to see some insights of the business that are reflected in the seasonability. And yeah, maybe we can benefit from this information, which is hidden in our data. Yeah, so we can play with a lot of parameters. We didn't have this need, but yeah, it's highly configurable. But what is nice is that if you just provide some data to the model, you don't have to configure anything. So this is the nicest thing about Prophet. This one. So basically, you just for the simplest case, you just need a data set with two columns. One column for time and the other column for the output that you want to predict. Basically, you just do a training data set, a test data set, and yeah, you can train your model. As we can see here, we just have to import Prophet. We will have our data set. This is the kind of input. And for example, we can train it for some data and we can predict for other data and we can compare the data. At least this is how we did. Basically, we just truncated some data and we train it for some months and we predicted for our interval that we wanted, and we just compared the real data with the prediction. So yeah, basically the nicest thing about this time series predictor is that it's very easy. So you just, if you want, you can provide zero arguments. You just have to do create the model with Prophet with no arguments and just call the fit, and after that, after you fitted the model, you can just prepare your prediction. How can you do this? As I said, we need some data from the future. And for the simplest case, we need time for the future. So basically we will create a future data frame, for example, for 1 year. And yeah, after this, after we have this data frame, this future data frame, we just have to call the model dot predict the future and we will obtain a forecast. Basically the output of the forecast, it's again, is the full data set, also the trained one and also the future one that we have. And we also have the Y hat, the real output. And this is the lower and the upper. So basically this is the prediction. So we have the forecast, this is the prediction, and this is the confidence intervals that we saw in the light blue in the graph. Yeah, so basically we can see that with these simple lines, we can just also have the plotting mechanism out of the box, some of them, and we can just put, send the command m.plot the forecast that we did. And basically, as I said, we will have the full data set plus the prediction. So basically the black dots are the real data points, and this is the fitting that the model is doing. The stronger blue is the main one, and the light blue are the confidence intervals. And we can also see the prediction. So here we don't have black dots because we only have the prediction. Any questions so far? So far, so good. Okay. So yeah, what is nice about this model is that for the beginning, you can just provide some data to it, and after that you can go and tweak it and so on. So after we have this this prediction, as I said, we can go so for some other components, and we can ask for the seasonability components. How can we do this? We have the out-of-the-box functionality plot components, and we want to plot the components of the forecast. And basically we have the trend, we have the prediction, and here we have the weekly seasonability and the yearly seasonability. Okay. Also, Prophet supports Python and R. So yeah, if there are any R fans out there, they will be happy. Okay. Let's see some other parameters that we can tackle. We saw the additional regressors. So basically we can add more regressors. So yeah, as we saw earlier, we just added some data that we have from the sensors. And yeah, basically we can add as many regressors as we want, and the prediction will take consideration of that regressors. But yeah, the downsides of adding more regressors is that you must provide feature data also for those regressors. So for example, if you have a sensor, you must also provide some predictions of those values for that sensor if you want to take that into consideration. So yeah. Okay. Also, you can, the cross validation takes some time. And if you want, you can also call the paralleling processing of this cross validation. And yeah, you will obtain a better performance of that cross validation. Yeah, I think it helps. Personally, I didn't use it because I was not aware that it exists. But yeah, I can confirm if you don't use it, it will take some time to do the cross validation. Okay, let's see what we have left. So yeah, this is the official documentation, as I said, and if someone wants to check it, we have this Fourier series that we are using for the seasonability. And holidays that we want to take into consideration. Also, we have some out-of-the-box holidays that we can use for some countries, but we can also provide some custom models. Yeah, we have all that we talked about. It's also explained here how the quality metrics are computed. We have this information here if someone wants to see it. And yeah, also we have the mechanism of cross validation, how it works. So yeah, I think this is it. Let's see if we have something else. Yeah, if there are any questions, comments, ideas.
Yes, Nat. Thank you, Alex, for the presentation. Maybe one question from me, but for the other participants, if they had time or curiosity to go through Prophet, maybe share their experiences.
I have worked a bit with Prophet, and we had to forecast the number of clients that will call in the call center in E.ON. And it was an interesting project. I guess the thing that I enjoyed most, it was the fact that I could see that there was an yearly
seasonality. Yeah, it's a yearly cycle. Yeah.
Thanks. Okay. Also, a weekly one. And yeah, this was very helpful.
Yeah, I think it brings some insights to the business that usually it's hidden in the data.
We had some problems when we had to split the customers on the topic on which they were calling in the call center. And this was a problem that we faced, but yeah, that's all.
Yeah, I would also like to add that, yeah, we did that comparison regarding XG Boost. And yeah, basically, the only thing that we had to do, we had as a data cleanup, because yeah, we had some, from time to time, we have some gaps in the data. And yeah, basically we had to do some cleanup in the data. And yeah, we had to do some resampling and remove some gaps. And this was it mainly. In XG Boost, we had to do more processing, and I think it's, yeah, from the analyst point of view, it's a lot of work to use XG Boost, for example. As I said in the beginning, XG Boost is not a time series predictor, but we just wanted to check the profit against XG Boost. Yeah. And yeah. Overall, I think it's very easy, at least for prototyping. It's easy to start with Prophet, and after that you can just fine tune it, do some tweaks over the parameters. So yeah, I think it's nice. Yeah, if there are any other questions, please.
Okay. Thank you. Sorry.
I wanted to add something. Yeah, because I said that I remember that. Yeah, for example, we've used like 5 or 6 regressors, and for the sensors that we've used, another thing that we should consider is this observation. So, for example, if I'm having 6 inputs and I want to predict the output of another sensor. Basically, those input sensors also require data from the future. So I think this is also a hard thing to do. We were able to do it because Yeah, we just had data from the future of those sensors. But for example, we also trained the model only with the weather forecast. And even though we've used only the weather forecast as a feature data, yeah, the model behaved well. But we should take into consideration if we have more than weather forecast in our input, we need, if we have five sensors, we will need, if we want to do a forecast for 1 week, we will also need predictions for those sensors in the future. So we have to take into consideration this aspect also. So depending how many input features you have, and depending for the time that you want to do the forecast, you will also need those input to have the predicted values for that interval. So basically, if you have five sensors and you want to predict 1 week, you will also have to predict or to have five predictors that will predict your data for that week, and you need to feed that input. And for the output, you don't need the feature data because you will predict it, but you need the feature data for the input parameters. So this is an aspect that must be taken into consideration. If you only use the weather prediction as an input, you are fine. You can just take the weather prediction. You will obtain, if you have only weather prediction and as an input, weather forecast as an input, and you want to predict for 1 week, you can just go to a weather API and get that feature data for the weather prediction. So it's easy. But if you have other inputs, like other sensors or something like this, you will have to predict those values somehow for that interval. So this is something that must be taken into consideration. If you have a lot of input features, you will have to take into consideration that you need a forecast for those values to provide to profit. So yeah, if the input parameters are growing, you will also need to take into consideration the feature data of those values, inputs. Yeah. This is just an observation that we need to take into consideration. Yeah, that's all.
But if you use the same feature data for all the sensors, it's not possible.
It's hard to say. Basically, if you need the feature data for those sensors, you can also use other profit models to predict data for those sensors, and you provide that data to profit, and profit will predict data for your output only. So let's say you have five inputs and one output. You need to provide data, past and future data, for those five inputs, and your profit will tell you the output data for your only one output. But again, I think you can use other predictors to predict the sensor. So for example, if you have five inputs, you can use five other profit models to predict only future data for those sensors. We didn't test it, but I was thinking that you can use this. So for example, you can train those models only with the weather forecast, for example. So you can train each one of those five profit models only with weather forecast, and you can obtain the predictions for those five inputs. You do a big data set, you provide to the inputs the past and the future predictions of the inputs to the profit, and profit will tell you the output variable prediction. But yeah, maybe you don't need from other sensors. Maybe you can use data that can be predicted. For example, maybe the humidity, maybe the air pressure. So these values can also be obtained from a weather forecast, for example. So yeah, maybe you don't need other sensors. Maybe you can use data that can be predicted, you know?
The past and the future data must be the same size? One week?
It must be the same size as the past and the future interval that you want to predict. So for example, if you want to predict the future for if you want to forecast for 1 week, you will need also the future data for the inputs for 1 week. And the total data set is the past plus that 1 week. So yeah, we can see here that when I'm requesting make future data frame and you say the period, this will only generate you data frame. So maybe you just want one sensor and you don't need weather forecast or something else. If you want, you can just use Prophet with past data, and you only need the data set and the sensor's value, a sensor value, for example. And as I said, you can have 5 predictors that can be trained for the past data. The past data can be generated in the future because yeah, it's the calendar that you have in the future, and you can have future data for each sensor. So the minimum data set is the date, time, and the value. So basically, yeah, when you request the future data frame, Prophet is generating the data set for you. So it will generate the time axis for you. And if you only have time axis and your sensor, you can just predict for 1 year for one sensor. You repeat the operation for all the 5 sensors, and you have the data from the future for those sensors if you want. But again, only if you want to provide more inputs to be taken into consideration, like more input features. If you have only a simple sensor, you don't need anything else. You just have to have past data, you request future data, and yeah, as I said, you will receive the future will contain the past and the future, and it's plotted right here, and your answer is right here. So basically the prediction contains also the past, so not necessarily the prediction, the forecast contains also the past and also the future. In this case, the future is 1 year. We've generated for 1 year, and I have the trend of that sensor, for example. I've trained it for 8 years, and I'm predicting the values for 1 year. And I can see that it goes like the trend. So this is we don't see any black dots. Because we don't see any black dots, it means we don't have sample values. This is the prediction. So from 2016 to 2017, we have the prediction. We can also see here that before making the prediction, okay, this is the tail. Yeah, so yeah, we ask for data to generate the time for 1 year, and yeah, we just see the full scale. So basically, the forecast contains also the past and also the future. But it's nice that the minimum data that you need to have is that it's just some time samples, some time series of your value. That's all. And with these two columns, you can just feed them to profit.
Okay. Any other questions? I'm going to close up for Eugen this evening.
Sure.
If not, thank you very much, Alexandru, for the presentation, and really hope to see you soon in another one of our meetings.
Thank you. It was a pleasure, and yeah, I also want to thank Eugen and the other guys for the job that they are doing, and yeah, thank you everyone for attending. It was a pleasure also.
Yeah, likewise. Have a nice evening. Bye.
Thank you. Have a good one.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Felicitări.
Merci. Thanks.
Seară bună, papa.
Merci, papa.